The VA provides healthcare services to more than 9 million veterans, but it also serves as the nation's backup health system. So you have a big question here. How ready is the VA if the outbreak grows worse? And specifically, will they be able to take care of our veterans, many of whom are over 60, making them particularly vulnerable to this virus? Perspective from Iraq War veteran and veterans advocate P.J. Rieckhoff, the man behind the Angry American podcast. How are you, my brother?
I'm good, Chris. Excellent work, man. I want to start by just thanking you for your leadership. You've really been stepping up and answering the call, and I know folks across the country have been inspired by you and your brother.
Well, when I got friends like you, it helps you learn how to do the right thing. And you flagged this to me a couple of weeks ago, that the VA had been offered help. They didn't take it. And now they're worried about their resources and being able to take care of veterans. What is the situation?
Well, the bottom line is that we are facing an unprecedented threat. We all know that. We've talked about this being war footing. Well, this is war footing. And we need to mobilize the entire country around this threat in a way we never have before. It's truly one team, one fight. And I just want folks to understand, maybe most of all, that the VA can be reinforcements. You mentioned it on the intro. The key part of their mission is to be the nation's entire backstop for the entire healthcare system. They can be a source of tremendous reinforcements in this time. They've got doctors, they've got facilities, they've got hundreds of billions of dollars in funding, but they've got to be called upon to do it. And until recently, you weren't hearing from the Secretary of Veterans Affairs. You also weren't hearing from the Secretary of Defense. You were hearing from CVS and Walmart, but you weren't hearing from these two great agencies that can be helpful. But I think we've got to understand that right now, that entire agency that serves 9 million people has only tested about 1,100 veterans. So they haven't been ahead of the game here. They haven't asked for enough resources. They haven't tested enough people. And it looks like right now we've tested more professional athletes than we have veterans. And that's a problem if we're going to stay ahead of this curve.
What is the inside scoop, because you're still so connected to the community, about why they haven't been called? Is it the political optics of militarization of this in the play?
You know, it comes down to leadership. I mean, across the board and everything we face right now, leadership, in my view, is going to be the determining factor. The president didn't mobilize the VA. He didn't mobilize the Department of Defense. Now he finally is, and they can add tremendous resources and be kind of a two-prong attack here in serving Americans. You know, we say in my show all the time, look for the helpers. Well, the helpers can come in the form of our veterans and our military at an unprecedented level. They have scale and scope in terms of logistics and medical personnel that no other agencies have in the entire federal government and rivals anywhere else in the world. So the president's got to ask the Secretary of Defense to step up. And then the Secretary of Defense has to be honest. And a couple of weeks ago, he told Congress he has everything he needs. Then in the recent bill, he asked for $16 billion. Even now, he's saying, we've got everything we need. But then simultaneously, they issued an order today calling up reserve folks who've been retired, over 1,000 of them, to serve at the VA. So there's been mixed messages, but we want Secretary Wilkie to succeed. We want him to be a lead element here, and we want folks to help. But he's got to ask for that help. And one way he did today, he asked for retired medical personnel who've worked at the VA. So I'm going to echo this message for him. If you're one of those folks, you can step up now. You can help. You can be a part of this fight. Go support the VA. It's a patriotic thing to do. You can serve your country in a way you've probably never done before.
So help me understand this, because you got governors all over the place worrying about capacity. Doctors saying they don't have enough PPE, the protective wear, and they're going to get sick, and we're going to run out of those first responders. You would think that you would jump to the military almost immediately. So let's think a little bit about what we're missing. I accept your answer, PJ, not just because you're twice my size, that it's a question of leadership. But we have to be missing something, that they haven't made that move yet, because they keep getting asked about the Army Corps of Engineers. And my brother says that he has been in touch with the Army Corps of Engineers, and that they're working it out. But there's so much more capability that hasn't been tapped. Why?
That's the question for the president right now. That's what the press corps should be asking him every day. We should be getting daily briefings from the Pentagon, from the Secretary of Defense. We should also be getting daily briefings from the Secretary of Veterans Affairs. We haven't gotten that. They've been kind of a black hole of information here. But the Department of Defense should be fully mobilized to attack this threat. In the same way we were 17 years ago today, to invade Iraq, we should be mobilized now domestically to provide all the resources we can. The military is great at logistics. It's not just about fighting. We can also move lots of people. We can feed lots of people. We have tremendous manpower. And the Department of Defense can be the lead element on everything from helicopters to building hospitals. That's going to start right now with your brother, for an example, with the National Guard being deployed in places like New Rochelle. The governors can deploy those National Guards, and they're doing that in over 22 states. If the president's smart, he will reinforce them with federal assets, and not just two Navy ships that are going to take a couple weeks to get to New York and San Francisco. We need a full mobilization of our military in any way they can help.
I don't get it. We must be missing something. There must be a political optic at play. And I don't even mean it as a criticism. There must be something in their calculus because they're so desperate for resources. And I had one guy say to me, it's a national security issue, that you have to make sure that the country is kept safe and that you don't have the military working on hospitals in a way that makes us vulnerable. But that kind of assumes that, like, we think we're going to get attacked in the homeland during this time, like, because we're vulnerable. But everybody else is getting beat up by the virus too, PJ. So it's not like anybody else is at full strength.
Well, the military is now testing across the force, you know, worldwide. And I talked this week on my podcast to the lead spokesman for our coalition forces in Iraq. And everybody in Iraq and Syria and around the globe is now finally getting tested. We got to keep those folks safe wherever they are. But they have tremendous resources here at home that should be mobilized. There should be no political opposition. This is a question of leadership. And we've got to adapt, improvise, and overcome, as we say in the military. And nobody does that better than the Department of Defense. You've got millions of people who faced an asymmetric enemy for over, you know, almost two decades now. You've got people who know how to handle adversity. You have people who know how to follow orders and get together and work together. It's a tremendous source of resources. And I think it can be a source of hope. You know, over a million of us have served overseas since the Iraq War started 17 years ago, and we're here at home. We can be a part of that lead force in helping, whether it's at the national level in leadership or it's in the community helping your neighbors and friends. We want to be a part of that reinforcement that happens, and the president's got to lead that fight, and he's got to ask for it. This is a time for a national call to action. So every day the president talks to America, he should also be telling us what we can do. That's the mistake we made after 9/11. We never enlisted the American people. We can do that now, and it's got to start with the president. And if he doesn't do it, we got to do it ourselves.
PJ Rieckhoff, thank you so much for much needed perspective. Appreciate it, brother. Be well
thank
to
you
and the family. Stay healthy.